Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Let's go.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show, co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Ladies,
say it again.
What do you want to know? How bad do you want to know it? What are you willing to do to find out? Tune in to the Men's Chronicles right here at the Sir Walter Jones Show at ABM Praise.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. This is the Sir Walter Jones Show. I am Sir Walter Jones, and I am so excited. It's Monday, Monday, Monday. Monday is Men's Chronicles. Men's Chronicles. It's a woman's guide to men. And every Monday, what we do is we sit around the table. The men come together from all walks of life, everywhere around the city and throughout the country. And we sit down and talk about men issues, things that are affecting men in America and around the world today. Don't matter, you know, what kind of man you are, what color you are, doesn't matter where you come from. We just talk about it. And it has, we have found out that this has helped a lot of women out there, a lot of married, whether they're married or whether they're single. And for those of you looking for men, it's kind of helped them understand the mind of a man. Today, what we're going to do is we're going to go a little different from a traditional or what we do here on the Sir Walter Jones Show, is that we're going to focus on the subject of racism. Racism, prejudice, and discrimination in America. It is a epidemic of epic proportion. It is something that is not new. It keeps rearing its evil head year after year. We don't know why it does it, but it does, and the panel is going to talk about it. We have an interesting panel here today to discuss this topic, and I think we're very well versed today here in the room, and we'll tell you about that in just a minute here. My brother Larry and I were talking on the phone, and this thing with the whole verdict with Brown, Michael Brown, and then the young man who was choked to death by a police officer and who was helped by his cohorts. We want to talk about that. America is in an uproar right now, and the protests are right now in the streets marching against this injustice that happened, and the courts have closed the doors and said we're done with it, and we wipe our hands to it. It's a problem. Now America has come together again, but in another way. And so Larry talked to me and says, you know, we need to do a program about this. We need to talk about this and do it now while it's still hot and in the minds of the people. Because just like 9-1-1, you guys kind of said, God bless America, you had your flags, and then that lasts for about a week or two, and then you went back to doing what you do. All right? We don't want this to end. So, in the room here, I have my brother Larry Jones, who's here. He has his own show called One Mic. Those of you who don't know him, you go to YouTube right now if you want to and type in Larry Jones, and you see all of his work that he's done out there in the music business and in media. It's Marilax Media, which is really everything. He's a production man, so whatever you need in production, that's what he does. So he has hit all of the social media sites. So go there and you'll see who he is. And we'll further introduce him as he explained himself. And we got Aaron Heeg here, who was a friend, a visitor here on the show just a few weeks ago. Hey, do you remember the subject you were talking about?
The relativity of going to church.
Going to church. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. It's church essential or something
right,
like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. So y'all can go to Spreaker.com and you can hear that show on that when he was here. We also have Apostle David Rodgers, who will be joining us in just a minute. Chicago traffic is no joke, y'all, especially at this time of day. So he'll be walking in a minute. And our co-host, Alvin C. Carter, who works at the school system, of course, he'll be coming in as soon as the kids let him go. All right? So we have a very diverse panel. Now, some of you who are not on Facebook and you listen to us live and you don't see the pictures of these who are here, we have a white guy.
That's right.
Okay?
We have the a white guy. Cream.
All right? Right.
In the Oreo.
Okay? And let's see. Apostle David Rodgers is a former Chicago police man. Okay? So it's so wonderful that we have him here. Larry Jones.
I'm Italian.
He's a black Italian.
Give me five, Larry.
He's a black Italian. And Larry Jones. And if you ever go to Larry Jones and say, no, you prejudice. And you know how people say, I'm not prejudiced. Two of my best friends are black.
Right.
Well, I want to tell y'all that Larry Jones married a white woman.
All right.
Look at Aaron. Yeah, Larry Jones married a white woman. So he is he's intraracial. He's a let's see, how would you call him? He's interesting. Okay. That's the best way I can put it.
Trying to change the world.
Yeah, he's trying to change the world. Good. My sister, Holly Jones, a wonderful woman of God, and that is his wife. And Larry goes to an interracial church, okay? And so he is perfect for this particular panel. And then we have Alvin C. Carter, who is a Mason, and who's part of an organization who, you know, sometimes is questionable.
Uh-huh.
He knows that because I see it in his face.
That's good.
Strange about
yeah. Uh-huh.
Me too.
Yeah, yeah. And he will he'll explain himself when the kids let him go. Okay. So what I want to do is, gentlemen, as the other ones will come in, they'll join in this conversation. What we try to do on this show is, and we have questions to ask all of you. We want to delve into. We got 2 hours, and what we're going to do is we're going to slowly delve into all of the topic, and we'll come to a resolve. We always come to a resolve on this show. Okay, uh-huh. That's very important because it's easy to just talk about a problem and then we walk away.
That's
but
right.
that's not helping nobody. All right. So what we're gonna do is what we like to do on this show is talk about the historics of a subject. Uh-huh. So let's spend the first half hour talking about the history of racism, and you guys can help us with this. Uh-huh. Okay.
Right.
Okay, where it stemmed from. So what I'm gonna do is there's a 1.5 maybe 2 minute file from the Oprah show from a woman, okay, who said something extremely interesting about racism, and then y'all tell me if you agree with it or not. Okay. Let me see. What's her name? Her name is Jane Elliott, and this is from a 1992 Oprah show. Okay. This is when Oprah. Remember, y'all used to talk about Luther Vandross, the fat Luther, and the skinny Luther. Well, this was the. Well, okay. Well, she's back. Well, you know, she's. Well, anyway, this is Oprah, 1992. Okay. Jane Elliott describing racism.
Brown-eyed people are the ones who originated or who founded every major religion on this earth. No white people have ever founded a major religion. Now you need to realize the contributions that have been made to society, to civilization, by brown-eyed people, by people of color. I'm talking about people of color here, folks. And most of us are not aware of those things because we live in a racist society and because we are educated by a racist school system that only teaches us about white contributions. And that's a fact. And if you don't like it, I'm sorry, but that's the way it is. If we would start telling the truth in schools, we would not have racism. We could cure racism in this country. Somebody said, I heard somebody. I heard somebody in the green room say that racism is inbred. No, it is not. Racism is not part of the human condition. Racism is a learned response. You have to be taught to be a racist. You are not born racist. You are born into a racist society. And like anything else, if you can learn it, you can unlearn it. But people like this choose not to unlearn it because they're afraid they will lose power if they share it with other people. We are afraid of sharing power. That's what it's all about. That's the reason men won't share power with women, because they are afraid they will lose power. People, if we would share power, we would empower many people so that we would all be more powerful. What we're dealing here with is mental illness. Racism is mental illness. Racism was defined by the Joint Council on Mental, President's Joint Council on Mental Health in Children in 1959 as being the number one mental health problem among children in the United States. And they didn't say among black children, they said among children.
I agree.
If you judge other people by the color of their skin, by the amount of a chemical in their skin, you have a mental problem. You are not dealing well with reality.
Wow. Did y'all hear that?
That's loaded.
That's loaded. It is. Yeah. It's loaded, and it's something to think about and talk about. Now, I think what she meant is extensive racism, because we all have some type of discriminating factor in us.
Right.
Okay? Because, you know, I have a daughter, and in some sense, I prefer her marrying a black guy. I'm not saying that if she chose a white guy, I would have a problem with it, but my preference is that she married a black guy. Why is
now,
that?
Now, why?
That's, there you go.
And I know why, the answer.
Uh-huh. Now, what do you think the answer is?
So she can have less problems
There you
with
go.
Other people.
Yeah, you can come close to that mic. I don't know if you
So she can have less problems with other people.
And you being in an interracial situation, you know how
Absolutely.
It is.
Absolutely.
So I probably on Facebook, among all my friends, I probably have the most white friends out of most of my Facebook friends. I don't just have them as white Facebook friends.
Right.
I know them.
Yeah.
Meaning they're my friends.
Yeah.
I know. Okay. But again, it's a social thing for me. It's like I just don't want to have those issues. And that's now we've got to find is okay, is that okay though? Mm-hmm. You know, is that is that and do you agree slightly with her? Her
I agree more than slightly with her.
Okay.
I agree with just about everything she said.
Okay.
I agree with.
Yeah.
You know, this journey we call life is a learning, right?
Mm-hmm.
Most people go through life and they don't change. Mm-hmm. They form an opinion and they stay who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some facts that's going to come up, like people that's less traveled are more racist.
Mm.
Uh-huh.
Less traveled.
People that stay in the same community,
yes, sir,
are more racist.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
People that have poor education,
mm-hmm,
black and white,
mm-hmm,
are more racist.
Yeah, yeah,
because they don't get out of their environment.
The environment.
They are taught by what they hear,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and not the reality.
So she says a mouthful
in
that dissertation on racism.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be difficult for me to say that I agree with everything that she said. There would be facets of her statements that I agree with.
Mm-hmm.
So my grid for measuring statements in heated topics like this is obviously a biblical grid.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea that she says racism is not an outgrowth of the human condition of one's heart, mm-hmm, I would disagree with that.
Okay.
I would agree with you there, too.
I would. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The dynamic that our educational system is tainted by potentially white supremacist,
mm-hmm,
educators,
mm-hmm,
and academic administrators,
mm-hmm,
I can see that.
Yeah.
I would also venture to say that the issue that this is a learned behavior, can, mm-hmm, it be unlearned? I agree, it can be unlearned through,
mm-hmm,
education after the condition of the human heart is altered.
Mm, mm. Okay, let's read this fact here, and I'm turning over to see what the apostle has to say here. The American Psychiatric Association, the APA, y'all know them, does not list racism in its diagnostic and statistical manual of mental disorder, the Bible of psychiatric worldwide. Most psychiatrists believe that racism is a cultural and social problem, not a matter of individual pathology. Harvard University psychologist Alvin Poussant thinks that that's a mistake, that they're not calling it, apparently, mental illness. He says extreme racism is treatable, and sometimes even lesser forms of racism are treatable because they have psychodynamics to them. He told Nightline, they don't exist as a social problem. They exist as psychological problems inside the individual. Your response, Apostle.
How are we defining racism?
Well, we haven't really defined it yet. We're going by what the young lady said on the Oprah show, that she thinks that it is a mental illness. Period. That's what she says.
For clarity,
mm-hmm,
and from experience and dealing with this a lot,
yeah,
definition is really important.
Right.
For for me, racism is just not simply, I hate you because of the color of your skin.
Mm-hmm.
I used the word earlier, preference.
Mm-hmm.
For some people, they just prefer to be around their kind.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's harmless. Mm-hmm. You're going to, mm-hmm. you know, some right. people like Alabama, some people like Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to go to the game, and you're going to put on the colors of your team, and you're going to cheer for your team. They're going to argue who's number one until they play the game.
Right.
But when you start talking about racism,
uh-huh.
then you have to talk about the systematic part, because that's the part that's impacting us.
Okay, the systematic part. I think, but there's three words here that we need to examine. There's racism, there's prejudice, and then there's discrimination. And yes. I think there's a difference between the three. Can we explain those for our general audience? Okay, mm-hmm. So let's start with discrimination.
Definition is real important.
Absolutely. Yeah. So what are you three you think discrimination is?
I think discrimination is acting on racism. Okay. I think discrimination is an act. Okay. I think discrimination leads to persecution.
Okay. You, Apostle, what do you think?
I believe that discriminate means to purposely attempt to destroy someone.
Okay.
And that's my definition from my experience. Mm-hmm. Someone else in another place might have a different may have a different definition.
Pass.
So discrimination.
Uh-oh, his mic is not on.
Here, I'll just
okay.
No, yeah, now you got it. So discrimination, from my vantage point, would be an internal viewpoint that leads to the thinking that someone's more superior than mm-hmm. another,
okay.
and they do, out of that mindset, acts to tear down and make people feel inferior.
Oh, okay.
Just like you gave him the best mic. He the white guy in the room. And he got all the bass in his voice.
That's the Alvin C. Carter's mic. Okay.
I'm going to have to bring my
drop it down, Jerry White.
Sure, you're right.
Oh, you just keep.
Prejudice. How would you define prejudice?
That's a difficult one, because they all tie in to mm-hmm. one another.
Mm-hmm.
You know, uh-huh. you know, prejudice is, me personally, I think it's the silent part. It's like all three are like on a tripod.
Sure.
They all connect to one another.
Yeah.
They do. Mm-hmm. But I think prejudice is more of a silent, mm-hmm. you know, we've all heard it in our communities. Mm-hmm. Like in the South, they show you. If they're prejudiced, they want you to know.
Yeah.
Up North, they don't want you to know they're prejudiced, but they're prejudiced. So yeah. I really can't define it, so I'm going to pass that along.
Okay, possible.
Uh-huh. Well, for me, prejudice is the psychology of the person. It's the preconceived notions that have been developed over time through mm-hmm. culture and through external influences that help to shape the mind. And I think prejudice is more dangerous than all of them.
Yeah.
Because the prejudice is the thing that is creating the systematic systems that are behind the scenes that are creating these barriers between races and classes of individuals.
Hmm.
So for me, prejudice is way more dangerous than discrimination and racism.
Wow. What do you think?
So prejudice, when I hear that word, I hear the word prejudgments,
yeah.
internal prejudgments Good. Upon people based on external factors
yeah.
that are ill-founded.
That's dangerous.
Yeah. That's very yeah. dangerous.
It's extremely dangerous.
Yeah.
So that's how I would view prejudice.
Yeah. What is a judicial system?
Where?
Yeah.
Are you talking about here in the United States? The judicial system?
Yeah, not the United States system, but what is a judicial system, period? What is it? Well, how could we define it?
What system?
Right.
I believe
that's it.
It's a system that is formed to judge.
Okay.
Right. Is a judicial system.
Mm-hmm.
They're formed to judge whether it be a crime
mm-hmm.
Of elected or sometimes selected
mm-hmm.
Officials
sure.
to judge.
Okay. So what I'm trying to do is analyze this whole prejudice thing, because that's really like the real word.
It's the cause.
Yes.
Causation. And this is why these talks for years have always stalled out.
Mm-hmm.
because we never deal with causation. Mm-hmm. Okay, if there is racism, why? If there's prejudice, why? If there's discrimination, why? What is the end result? Yeah. What is the goal? What is being attempted to be accomplished by exercising these three mechanisms? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So when you bring up the question of the judiciary, mm-hmm. okay, I'm a former cop. Mm-hmm. I had to adhere to the law of the land, and then I had to enforce that law against people who wouldn't adhere to it. But now, if the ones who are making the laws mm-hmm. have a prejudiced, preconceived notion about people who they have termed to be animals, mm-hmm. then that law is going to be bent and slanted against a certain group of individuals.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do you think, now we're going to America, where we live right now, mm-hmm. Larry Jones, racism. Now, we know there's really only one. There's a human race. But we was using the word racism for the sake of argument, okay? America, mm-hmm. does it still exist in America?
Absolutely. Anybody that says that racism does not exist is a ostrich with their head deep in the sand.
Yeah.
Deep in the sand.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, okay.
So much to the fact, I'm going to make a bold statement here, that if you call yourself a Christian and you say that there's no racism, mm-hmm. I believe God himself has a problem with you being in denial.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. Pastor Aaron?
Without question.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I don't even need to explain that. Without question.
Okay. Okay. Apostle?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, we have a president, all right, who's in his second term. And I've heard a lot of African Americans across the country saying, great, it's over. We finally have our man. Racism is about over. And watching Fox News, I've heard them over and over say, racism doesn't exist anymore. Y'all got you. You got a black president now. I've heard them say that over and over again. Yeah. Okay. Uh-huh. Now, let me
just
ask you a question.
The fact that they say y'all have a black president.
Watch it. I come from Oklahoma.
Just the fact that they have to even say that means racism still exists.
Yes. Yes. Let me watch this. Do you think, this is the question to the panel, do you think since the time he became president that the people who are racist became more prominent, they became more
true
public
colors
with it? Was it because of his election, or a new racism came up and people realized, okay, maybe I am racism, that's why they're fighting the system? What do you think happened?
Listen, if you take a dog, mm-hmm. and dress him up like a cat.
Yeah.
And call him a cat name.
Yeah.
Felix. Eventually, that cat will see a squirrel, just like that cartoon.
Yeah.
And when that cat sees that squirrel, mm-hmm. he gonna forget you dressed him up like a cat.
Right.
He's gonna do what a dog does. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, yes, a lot of people that were pretending that they weren't,
mm-hmm. they realized that they were.
Oh, it was uncontrollable.
Yeah.
It was uncontrollable. And I'm not taking up for the president. Uh-huh. I'm just saying it is what it is.
Right.
Because when we get further down in talk, I'm going to tell you about an awakening that I had to have. Because you know me since the 70s. Uh-huh. I used to be a militant, tam-wearing, black, right fist in the air brother mm-hmm. in the 70s, and I want to tell you why.
So we
have to, this conversation, we really, really have to dig deep and be honest with ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Apostle, you think that the election of this interracial president has affected the nation as far as racism?
Nope.
It has not.
We've been in the same place spiritually and psychologically since our inception. Mm-hmm. We haven't changed at all.
Okay.
It's nothing different. Mm-hmm. And because I travel, I go to other nations. Mm-hmm. We have churches in Africa. We have churches in Haiti. We have churches in Tegucigalpa, Honduras. You know, it's a dominantly Hispanic-speaking nation. Mm-hmm. We see the impacts of the globalization of racism and economic, what I call economic terrorism, mm-hmm. on other nations. Mm-hmm. It's not changed. Sure. The picture that we try to paint of it not existing is totally false. The only thing that President Obama's election did was it brought it to the forefront because he's received more attacks of disrespect and dishonor, which we understand from our perspective because we go through it every day. But now he's put on MSNBC and Fox News. He goes to a meeting with global leaders and they won't even shake his hand. Right. We know that.
Right.
The people that have not experienced that may not understand it from that perspective, but no, it didn't change. It's always been there. It's just on television now.
Sure, sure. Alvin Carter, I just walked in. Do you think that the president, the same question to you, his election has caused us to see racism more?
I won't say it caused us to see racism more. No, I will. It had subtly died down to some degree. I believe that the racists turned it up. Because in the first term, or the onset of his election, they felt threatened.
Right.
When they realized it wasn't a threat, now they've turned it up even higher because it's like now we have to reposition those or put the people back in their place who thought they had been liberated.
Okay.
So the only way to test whether or not liberation has really taken place is to do what I'm accustomed to doing and seeing if I can still get away with it. See, what we've seen now is no longer Jim Crow. Is Jim Crow Esquire.
I see.
Because what they used to get away with just socially and not being brought to the forefront legally, now the law has basically said we endorse this. In the South, the judge, the cop, they were in the cahoots together because it was a small town or they were good old boys together. They were Klansmen even or in other secret societies, if you will.
Oh, no.
But now that particular cultural norm is not as normal today or prevalent. You don't see it. You used to see it in your cartoons. Fred and Barney would go to the Water Buffalo meetings. And you would see it in different scripts of different shows in the 70s. Now you would only see that the blacks that would arise to certain places of fluency is because they knew what to say and how to say it to the right people at the right time. Now culture has allowed it to not be what it once was, and some people were accepted because some people became more free to accept and embrace culture and race and realize it's not separate races, as you would say, it's just the human race. But those who are used to the power and the position that goes with it are saying, wait a minute, let's see if this is really working, because this can't happen again. However, I have another take. I think they're using the president as a scapegoat, and he's allowing himself to be used as a scapegoat, too, because he's not embracing the potential of his power. He's strictly a kinetic power piece, a kinetic power source at this point.
Sure, sure.
Not potential.
Yeah, yeah.
He's potential, not kinetic. I'm sorry, I had it backwards.
Right, right. Yeah, and we know that the anybody who sits in that seat at the White House is really almost like a puppet because he has a cabinet, and he has other people who influence who he says and what he does. And then he gets to blame for whatever, whether it's good or bad, he gets to blame. So we can't put the everything on the lap of the president and say, do something about this. We have to do something. So as we go into this next hour, we're going to talk about the church, the responsibility for the church. And also we want to talk about, Aaron, the responsibility of the Caucasian. Okay, I'm going to talk about a movie that I just saw a documentary called The Third Reich, okay, on the History Channel. Very interesting. We're going to talk about it, and you give us a response on the responsibility of the Caucasian.
I'll be happy to.
Okay, great, great, and we'll go further. Listen, this is the Sir Walter Jones Show, and I'm excited to have this panel here. We're going to take a little short break. Marvin Gaye needs to sing.
Okay. Sexual healing.
Yeah. No. That's the wrong show. That's the wrong show. I'm the only single guy here. All right. We'll be right back.
Log on to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
We'll be right back.
watched too many of you cry. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love. Don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
You know we've got to find a way
to bring some love in here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs. Punish me,
sister,
with brutality.
Sister,
talk to me,
sister,
so you can see.
Sister,
oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on?
Oh, everybody thinks we're wrong. Oh, but who are they to judge us simply cause our hair is long? Oh, you know we've got to find,
bring some understanding here today.
Oh, 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 picket lines and picket signs. Punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me. You can see what's going on. Yeah, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. I'll tell you what's going on.
Right,
right on. Right on.
Ladies, what do you want to know? How bad do you want to know it? What are you willing to do to find out? Tune in to the Men's Chronicles right here at the Sir Walter Jones Show at UBM Praise.
Oh, yeah. Welcome back, y'all. Marvin Gaye. Hey, what's going on? Dude, that was one of the most spectacular songs ever written in not just in soul music, but in music period. Mm-hmm. Talked about the day, the time. History repeats itself. And just like we have racial injustice today, God had to deal with it back in Bible days. It is something that will never go away until Christ comes back. Every country, every empire has had to deal with this. And I think we cannot look at racism as a black and white thing.
No.
Unfortunately, y'all forgetting about the Hispanics and the Asians and those who
and
are...
And the Indians.
That's, you know,
right.
Yeah, we can't. So
Indians,
this is,
who are they?
Yeah, right.
Talking
exactly.
About, I mean, wait a minute. Who are we talking to?
Huh?
We say Indians. Who are we talking to?
Right, they are.
Americans.
Right. The Native Americans.
Oh, Native Americans. Oh,
and, well,
okay.
Then the Indians as well.
Now, all the Indians, you must acknowledge them too. Yes. Some would say First Nations people.
There you
First Nations people.
Absolutely. Oh. They all. So that's why we call this racism, prejudice, and discrimination. It's all of it.
Are they all the same or are they different?
No, we talked about it before you got here.
Okay. You missed out. Late students always ask the question.
Go to Spreaker, Alvin, right now and rewind the show. Okay. Now, before we went to break, I was addressing a question to our brother Aaron Heeg about the responsibility of the Caucasian the people. And he did want to say something about President Obama. Okay.
Yeah, so before his first administration took off, I had started thinking that in the next decade there would become great outbreaks of social chaos in our country.
Yeah.
And a couple of years prior to his first presidential race, I gave great thought and deliberation to who I would vote for in his first attempt at the presidency. And it was clear to me that I needed to vote for him. I did not ascertain fully why I needed to vote for him. I just felt in my heart he was the man that out of the providence of the creator of this nation, he had chosen to take this office. And as he came into office, I began to recognize that the providential guidance of God would begin to use this man in this office as one that would pull back the curtains on real issues that still reside in the soil of this country. And I believe that we're seeing an uncovering of that right here today.
Yeah. Now, you said something very interesting, because if you know biblical history, you understand that God also used the enemy to bring understanding and light to the Jews.
That's right.
So those of you who feel that, God would never put that man in place, but yada, yada, yada. Well, that's not necessarily true, because there's some things that God needs to bring to your understanding of what toilet you're
in. That's right. Now, listen, I have relationships with probably more white, fundamental, evangelical, patriotic Christians in the Southwest than most of my Caucasian friends. And I have never in any presidential race seen so many efforts and attempts to keep an African-American out of office like I saw in President Barack Obama's first run at the presidential office. Sure. So I had to stop and ask myself the question. Letters were sent out to most of the evangelical world in the state of Oklahoma saying, do not vote for Barack Obama.
Wow.
Don't vote for him.
Wow.
Christian patriots.
Yeah.
But yet he finds himself in office.
Wow.
Why?
Why?
More reports, more letters sent out saying, don't vote for him, but yet he shows up.
He shows up.
I believe it's the providential guidance of God.
Wow.
Allowing it to happen.
Yeah. And that's something that's, again, y'all, you know, these are some, I brought these men in because I knew that they would bring in what's called the shocking truth. You may not agree with a lot of things we're going to say, especially Apostle Rodgers being here. You may not agree with with a lot of things that's going to be said at this table. But I'm telling you, but when we get through with this show, you're going to hear a diversity of
fire start.
Yeah, it's going to be wonderful.
And we might not agree with everything
each
other says.
Exactly, because I don't agree with you now. So, because I've been agreeing with you until this time. You see what I'm saying? But what I will want to say here, though, I saw a documentary about the Third Reich. Y'all know that's the Hitler situation. Right. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, when Europe came and overtook, and Hitler, you know, committed suicide and what have you. At least that's what the books say. Okay.
You play chess.
I said, at least that's what the book
said. No, do you play chess?
Yeah.
You know, the king never leaves the board?
Yeah, anyway, I can't go in that with y'all.
Stay on topic.
On topic.
Yeah, yeah. When Europe and America saw the atrocities of the Jewish people, and they saw all those thousands and thousands of dead corpses, okay? Ooh. What they did was they gathered up all of the Germans who were in that area and says, why didn't you tell us about this? And the German people said, we were told a lie. We didn't know this. And the European army and the American army says, you're lying to us. Yes. How could you live that close and not even smell the bodies that were here? And so what they did was they gathered, they divided Germany. They had all these millions of Germans to come, and they had them to bury the dead of the Jews, okay? Ooh. They had them to bury the dead, and then they moved them out of their houses and put them in camps and little other areas where they were destroyed. They said, now you rebuild yourself. We're out of here. And millions of Germans died because they sat and watched this happen to the Jews.
Yeah.
And they said, you were held responsible for this. You didn't tell the world this was happening.
We were there, too.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure we were. So my question to you, in America, among the whites here, they are seeing this happen. They know it's happening, okay? Some are a part of it, but I mean the ones who are not racist. What I'm seeing today, though, in the streets of Ferguson and New York and Chicago, I've seen a lot of white people marching. Which is, and I'm going to give it to you. I see a lot of white people marching, which is really a wonderful thing to see. And they're saying Black Lives Matter. I'm seeing this from white people. Okay. Prior to seeing that, I didn't have much hope into whites because they were silent and they were living in their luxury
utopia.
And not saying nothing. I'll let them Black people kill each other. Okay, let the cops do it. At least that'll, you know, free. Okay, so what's your answer to that? You kind of said something in your last thing about Obama. Uh-huh. But what's your response to that?
So I'll go right, very personal. About 7 months ago, I took a trip to Cincinnati with an African American brother out of Inglewood, and in that car trip to Cincinnati with this brother, the issue of racism came up. And to make a long story short, because it was a long trip, I'll put it in a capsule. I was illuminated at the issues that still were unresolved in my white ancestral heritage. And things started clicking off inside of me that I've been part of family gatherings within my household, extended family, where racial comments, slurs, divisions had been being said, and I was remaining silent. Mm. So in that car ride, I said to myself, I believed I was moved by the grace of God to say, hey, Patrick, listen.
Wow.
I'm asking you, as I accept responsibility in behalf of my white ancestors, to forgive me for being silent when racial comments are made.
Wow. Wow.
And
yes, sir.
I made an internal resolution at that moment that if I would ever find myself in a family gathering, I don't care who the family member was that was saying a racial comment, I would confront it and challenge it immediately.
Wow.
Well, guess what? One day after getting back from Cincinnati, I find myself at a Mother's Day brunch and an extended family member making contrary derogatory marks against the Black race. I said, listen, Auntie so-and-so, you can't just go ahead and think that you can run over this race because you think you're superior. So I believe these national, regional outbreaks that are directly related to racial issues, it's drawing more white Caucasians out of the closet to say, I can't be silent any longer.
Yes. Larry first and then Apostle.
Now, I'm very glad that you asked this because this, out of everything that's happening, I was like you just 2 weeks ago.
Hmm.
Now, I'm going to say something and I have a, you know, I think my Facebook is maxed out. Whatever.
It's all right.
I had to get rid of a few folk. But in my face, and it's pretty much half and half. Half white, half Black, right? Because that's where I wanna live in my world. That's where I wanna be. Exactly. But let me say something that's very important. I was very disheartened that we always run to what looks like us. So white people, if it's a white officer, you're going to defend the white officer.
Right.
Well, maybe he was threatened, or maybe he felt this. Well, maybe they were doing something. And African Americans are of course, we're going to go, they shouldn't have did this. They shouldn't have did this, right? There was something that happened to me very profoundly when I was younger, Walter, in the 70s, we were the second African American family on our block. We moved there, I think it was 1966. 1966.
I was the baby.
Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And my parents still live across the street from there till today.
Right.
My school was changing then. It was white. It was all white. But then when we got there, from the time that I started to the time that I graduated, it was just about all black. And this is before I got to high school. And I never forget, I saw this white kid getting beat up daily. And it disturbed me.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to my dad. And I says, Dad, they're persecuting this guy. They beating him up every day. It's not right. I don't feel right in my spirit, in my compass. It don't feel right. This was my aha moment, my Mecca moment. To my dad said, if you stand by and let him get beat up, you are the one that's beating him up.
Mm.
That's what my dad said to me. Mm. And I'll never forget it. Mm. I went to school that next day, and just as sure as the sun shined, they were beating him up again.
Mm.
My brother will tell you, back in the day, I can handle my business.
Oh, yeah. Still today.
Yeah. And I had to go kick some tail. And they were looking at me like I'm crazy.
Yeah.
And I threatened the entire school.
Yeah.
Touch him again, mm-hmm. you're going to have to deal with me.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what we have to, that's the reality that we as Americans have to come to.
Uh-huh.
And because there's something I call the Great Divide. And I'm going to make sure everything else I say is shorter than this, but I have to get this out.
Mm-hmm.
Half of my Facebook, all of my white Facebook friends, my white Christian Facebook friends are Republican. Just about, I would say 90%.
Mm-hmm.
90% of my African-American Christian friends
Democrat.
Are Democrat.
Right.
Okay, the Democrats listen to, look at CNN. The Republicans look at, it's called the Great Divide.
Right.
We have to realize that there is money to be made off of racism. There's money to, the media is making money.
Uh-huh.
Yes, it's true. You could, something could happen. You watch CNN for 5 minutes, then turn to Fox. Fox is going to be saying totally opposite of what CNN is saying.
That's true.
But what happens is we as a culture, and I call it the herd mentality, we get fed this stuff day in and day out. We get baptized in it.
That's true.
So your belief becomes one-sided.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
And so I don't believe, I'm going to say a bold statement. I don't believe that you can bleed one color or the other, Democrat or Republican, and still call yourself a Christian.
Right.
Because
right.
God is speaking, and he's not agreeing 100% with any of them.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Apostle, that's deep.
I want to go back to something that Pastor Heeg was talking about, mm-hmm. his awakening. The problem with us is we don't want to have any awakening.
Mm.
Many of us are extremely comfortable in our mindsets, and we tend to hang around people that make us comfortable in nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a bit of an oxymoron. I'm an African American. I'm a Christian, and I'm an independent conservative.
Mm.
I choose to lean towards Republicans because, of course, of my religious stance.
Sure.
I just can't go with the Democratic Party.
Right.
So I didn't vote for Barack Obama in either election.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the fear of the Republican Party to put my guy on the ballot, I wind up having to write his name at the top of the paper, which mm-hmm. was Ron Paul, because he was the only one that asked for a line-by-line audit of the Federal Reserve.
Sure. Yeah.
I understand racism from the economic side
mm-hmm.
because I'm a business person and I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
And being a Christian and a person in business and a person active in politics, I see the psychological mass programming that goes on through media to create certain mindsets so that great divide exists.
Mm-hmm.
Because the leaders that were chosen for, they were selected for the African-American community to say that they are the leaders, they are not our leaders.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So they continue to feed this, and then you have this side feeding this side, and we never get to a place mm-hmm. where we can deal with it. And the last thing I want to say about my brother to my left is his awakening was something that happened to Pastor David Wilkerson. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't like David Wilkerson, and they don't.
Now, you got to tell the people who the brother to your left is.
Oh, Pastor Heeg.
Yeah.
Okay.
Aaron. Yeah.
What's his name?
Aaron.
Yeah. Aaron. Uh-huh. Okay. Right. David Wilkerson probably pastored the largest interracial church in New York. Mm-hmm. And he did that at a time where that was not popular at all.
Yeah.
And so I think we need to look at the lessons of those who have succeeded in this arena, and we need to create models to reproduce those around the country, because yes, there are not a lot of Caucasian pastors uh-huh. that will say anything yeah. about this blight on yeah. our country yeah. for the fear of losing membership.
Wow. That's it.
So I got just a couple of pieces yeah. of feedback to give. Mm-hmm. The first piece of feedback was when I had my awakening mm-hmm. in this interaction with this African-American brother out of Inglewood.
Yeah.
It not only awakened me to accept responsibility as a human being mm-hmm. For the sins of my white ancestors, yeah. it also awakened him, because he recognized that there were racial slurs and undertones right. in his black ancestral history right. towards the white man.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So together we had a mutual Absolutely. Exchange of forgiveness, yeah. which ultimately released healing yeah. between he and I.
Wow. Because it goes both ways.
That's
you know?
Right.
Everybody want to look at you. They look at you. They see you white. They think you live in it. You got a perfect credit rating because you're white.
Wrong.
You know, you live in a big house in the suburbs because you're white.
Yeah, right.
Oh, no.
Man, that's some foolishness.
Foolishness.
You know?
Yeah, I think there's a hypocrite spirit in America that's so large, it's amazing. I see on Facebook, and I received a text message from a friend who wants us to boycott the Exodus movie this weekend, okay? And the reason why he wants us to boycott it, because there are no black figures on the Exodus. Now, if you look at the Ten Commandments back in the 1950s,
Absolutely.
If you notice that if you did see any black people,
they were the slaves they were way there. Far in the back.
Okay, now they were black, but the Pharaoh in Egypt, right. he was white. He was and the rest of them, okay. Right. All right, so
now,
turn him back on.
This is what I agree with that lady, what you she was saying. What she, the lady, some of the stuff, I don't know if you, some of the stuff that lady was saying on Oprah's show is, it's I agree with,
yeah.
because American history is so tainted.
Mm-hmm.
It is so tainted and so incorrect.
Right.
It is, and it's some of it is just it's just asinine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, including this great country we lived in. When you really look at it,
mm-hmm.
we were a rebellious country. Mm-hmm. It wasn't yes. just about religious freedoms. Mm-hmm. Do you do your homework?
Right.
We don't like to look. I live in the truth, whether it hurts me or not.
Sure.
I live in the truth.
Yeah.
And we gotta get real to get past this uh-huh. this foolishness.
Yeah, yeah, and it is pure foolishness. And I think you brought your guys as we get ready to go to another break. Y'all, you both brought up some wonderful points, especially on Sunday. They said Sunday 11 o'clock is the most hypocritical hour of the week.
Segregated hour
of the week. Okay, all right. So we got white church, and then we got the black church.
Yes,
we've got the black. Gospel Awards, the Stellas.
We got the Stellas.
We got
which
the
I
White
hate.
Gospel Awards, which is the Dove. Okay, all right. right? We had Soul Train, right. and then we have American Bandstand.
American Bandstand.
Okay, we got all this. Now these are Christians, right?
Right.
Because you know who got these separate. Okay, you got Republican, and you got Democrat. Even right. though there are more than two parties in America,
yes.
those are the only two those that only always two. Become the mayor, the governors, and the presidents, what have you, okay?
Yes.
So we're on these two separate sides here, and it's amazing. Mm. I see Aaron Heeg last time he came here, he walked through the black neighborhood, he walked through the alley, bold man,
yeah.
okay, just walked through it. He said, you know what, when I see you, I see my brother.
Yeah.
right. You know, I don't see, you know, all this other stuff, I see my brother.
Right.
But unfortunately... A guy like him can't walk through our neighborhood without us. I worried for him.
Right.
I said, oh, my goodness, they're going to whoop his butt. You know mm-hmm. why they're going to whoop his butt? Mm-hmm. Because what they were brought up, the white man in my neighborhood, they go with the man, this is the man that got me down, this is the man that enslaved me, oh, no. Mm-hmm. So there's something got to happen in our children. What right. can we do
right.
to get them to stop thinking about the white guy like Aaron Heeg's children may be thinking about us?
Why do little black kids run when they see a police
there
car?
You go. And let's talk about this on this next break. Hey, listen, Martin Luther King want to talk. Give him a chance, and we'll come back right after this break. This is the Sir Walter Jones Show.
all we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Oh, but my toys I will play. But now I put away these things for the bell for opportunity rings. This is a brand new day. I've made my start and I'm on my way. I can be anything I want to be. Watch me and you will see, because I am somebody. I am somebody.
Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm to die, 'cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. And I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there've been times that I thought I could last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry on. It's been a coming, but I know a change gon' come. Oh, yes it will.
The Sir Walter Jones Show, co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
That's
Sir
right.
Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who show is this?
Ladies, what do you want to know? How bad do you want to know it?
Monday.
What do you want to do to find out? Tune in to the Men's Chronicles right here at the Sir Walter Jones Show at UBM Praise.
Welcome, welcome back, everybody. This is Sir Walter of the Sir Walter Jones Show. Ah, man, it's hot. It's hot up in here. I'm telling you, I wish we could have a show where we just record all of the stuff that's talked at the table during the break, because these guys was going at it.
And they were signifying.
And they were signifying and throwing bricks.
Started talking about Apostle's mama. Man, I didn't even know the white boy had white jokes like that. You know what I'm saying?
He played it up.
Oh, yeah, he did. He did. Apparently we need to stay on a certain subject here, because this got to be part two, because it's, you can't solve racism in 2 hours.
No.
But we will try to dig deep into some of the topics that we just need to discuss that y'all ain't talking about in your churches. Now we're talking about elections and the Republican versus the other party. Okay. Now I'm gonna be honest with y'all. I voted for Huckabee.
Me too.
In 2008.
I was a Huckabee fan.
Yeah, I was a Huckabee fan. Okay. Apostle Rodgers said something very interesting. He says he stick to Republican because of their values, although he voted for the other young man, the independent.
Ron Paul.
Okay. And Aaron said that he wanted to strongly vote for Obama because of, well, you heard what he said, and which will go against his people's party line, basically. Okay. And so we have men in the room who have values, who really care, not so much about the man in the office, but about the plight, about the situation that's going on in America, which will affect me and my children,
right.
Okay, and my house and where I go to buy my food,
income,
all of these things here. But I look at racism in the media. Let's talk about that, okay?
Please.
Walter Cronkite, Tom Brokaw, Peter Jennings, Dan Rather, these were men of standard.
Yes.
All right? And when they reported the news, they reported the news. They didn't report what they thought. They didn't dig into what they saw and said, no, this is what I think it is. They reported it, and then they said, now you decide. Okay? That was American news back in the day. Then came cable news, which caused, which became a interpretation of the news, mm-hmm. more so than reporting it.
Right.
So we have MSNBC.
Editorials and commentaries versus actual facts.
Actual facts, okay? So we have MSNBC, CNN, and Fox are the three largest ones that get our news. Although I get my news from Steve Colbert and the Jon Stewart Show. Okay. I really do. Okay. Yeah. So you turn on MSNBC and you know for a fact that it's a very liberal, very democratic, and they are for everything, okay? Then you turn on Fox, and they're Republican, and it seems like and if you're black watching it, it appears that you hear a lot of racism in it.
You're going to get mad in 5 minutes.
You're going to get very upset at it, okay?
Any 5 minutes, mm-hmm. you are.
And as much as they'll say that's not what we're doing, when you hear it, you want to turn it off. And I try to give them a chance. I really do.
That's the problem. That's the ticket. That's the tool. Mm-hmm. That's the reason they do it, because they know someone's going to come and listen again just to see what made you so angry. I got to see this for myself.
Well, there was one of the gentlemen you named did a report about the media. And when I get it, I'll get it to you.
Okay.
It's astounding when I watched it. Of course, for some reason, it came on late at night.
Mm-hmm.
And it talked about what I call the Great Divide again. CNN, if you study how these cable news medias came up, it's very cheap reporting.
Of course.
Because they don't have to have offices everywhere. Yeah. You know, they can just send out a field reporter because it's cable. So their cost was very low. It's very it's an economical thing.
Mm-hmm. Like reality TV.
Exactly. And so what happens was they did some cheap reporting, and to make a long story short, they made something like $100 million.
Mm-hmm.
Fox saw it. They did the same thing. They says, well, if they have this much of the pie as far as population, we know that we can get on the other side and we can get this much of the population. And they did the same thing. Fox did.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to watch this. And what's the lady's name? Coulter?
Ann Coulter.
They literally asked her, do you believe a lot of the stuff that's coming out of your mouth?
Right.
I'm not even going to tell you what she said. I can't believe that she could say it right on camera. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with CNN.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to understand that their agendas are economical.
Mm-hmm.
It is, and it force you. But we're the herd mentality.
Mm-hmm.
We're forced into one party or another.
Yeah, we are.
They're gangbangers. You're a Crip, you're a Blood, you're a disciple, or you're a vice lord.
Right.
Choose ye one or the other.
Yeah,
you're
not a free. One,
you got to choose one.
Yeah.
Right.
The issue is the word media comes from the word medium.
Sure.
Means in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
These entities are controlled by corporations.
Absolutely. Right.
These corporations then control political parties,
mm-hmm. exactly.
who create agendas that create racism that you feel on the ground.
Yes. Right.
So if all of your information is coming from a controlled source,
yes.
then you lose your ability to do critical thinking.
That's right.
This is what's wrong with our community.
Absolutely.
So if they say something, if they use a derogatory word, those people, now everybody in America is talking about that verbiage,
mm-hmm.
but we're not having the conversation about, okay, where is our medium? Where is our news? Who are those equipped people who qualify to create a different perspective, a different viewpoint? We're always victimized because we don't want to do the critical thinking.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We don't want to discipline ourselves, and we don't want to invest in other things.
Yeah.
So we go into the Democratic Party or we go into the Republican
Party,
and we have no idea what their real agenda is because we don't want to study.
That's true.
And so instead of dismantling the whole thing because it's not working, our nation is, what are we now, $117 trillion in debt.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all these guys are graduating from Harvard. I'm sure they took Economics 101 that said if you spend more than you make, you go into debt. Mm-hmm. I'm sure they took that.
Yes. Yeah.
And instead of making your own decision.
Money. They're not spending their own money, so that's why they don't care.
Yeah.
So instead of making the decision to dismantle the whole thing, let's rebuild something that makes sense. Let's get 10 people from this country that know how to balance a checkbook and put them in power and put a team behind them to get this country out of it. We keep going into the same dark corner with the same dark agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going to work. America cannot sustain itself anymore. Right now, every American owes $683,000 just to make us break even.
That's true. That's true. And we look at the Koch brothers, and we look at, really, Associated Press. Everything comes from the top. okay? You look at Murdoch, and you look at the ones who are influenced. Now they're also influenced. Everybody's influenced by someone. Even the one at the top is influenced by someone else.
Influence is different than control.
Those
outlets are controlled.
Sure. Yeah, control and influence is true. Go ahead.
There's a compass, right? Mm-hmm. My wife, whenever there's, even through the police brutality, mm-hmm. I'll turn on Fox, then I'll turn on CNN, then I'll go right over to Fox. And my wife always asks me, why are you doing this to yourself?
I do this too.
I
do this too.
Because if I allow myself to be baptized by one or the other, then I'm a fool.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And I can say that I know your show is about non-defending. I can offend myself.
Sure.
Then I'm a fool. I choose to have my head in the sand. Mm-hmm. Because if I believe all of one media, mm-hmm. that's not the word of life. It's mm-hmm. not the Bible. It's not the book of life you're hearing coming out of this mortal man's mouth. Mm-hmm. Like he said, study for yourself. They're going to say what they're paid to say. Mm-hmm. And here's a compass. If you can turn on Fox, and I'm not talking about the guests, if neither of the people that work there, if nobody ever has anything positive to say about Barack Obama, then you know it's tainted.
Yeah.
That's it, right?
You're right.
And if you can turn on CNN, and they have nothing positive to say about the Republican Party or anything they stand for, then it's tainted.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
It's time for America to wake up mm-hmm. and do some studying and stop being lazy and let these talking heads keep us divided.
Yeah.
We need to say something about the whole Barack Obama phenomena. It is assumed that because you don't agree with him, that you're not black, or that you don't, with him, and all of this kind of stuff.
Oh, right.
Let me tell you something about.
Oh, you're anti-black.
Real love demands that we bring corrective adjustment.
Yeah.
And so what has happened is, if you don't understand that realm, people are talking about from what they think they would do in that arena. Yeah. This man has a wife and children, and I'm sure that he's because he's a very well-read man, what has gone on in this country in terms of black political leaders and people who would desire to speak out. He's not stupid.
No, he's not.
So we need to keep that in mind while we're placing all of these uncommon demands on him. I didn't vote for him, but I support his right to be there and to provide leadership. But mm-hmm. I also understand that leadership has to come through a censor that has already been predetermined. Okay, you can be in here, but you can only go so far. And if you don't understand that in the political arena, especially coming from Chicago, then you don't have any right to say anything about what that man is doing in the White House in order to preserve his wife and his children.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah. Here's what I'm going to say. Don't get caught up in the hype. Here's what we do. If you go outside your door and you see a group of people running, you start running.
You start running.
Naturally, you run. You don't know what they're running for.
The herd mentality is what I call it.
So the MSNBC, sometime when I'm watching that show, mm-hmm. I'm saying, that's right. Yeah, you're right. You're right. I watch it for 3 hours. You're right. And then I found myself saying, you're right to it's okay for abortion is fine. Mm-hmm. It's okay for homosexuals to marry each other. I start saying, you're right to all of the immoral values.
Come on.
And then I had to stop and say, wait, whoa. Right. I'm saying you're right to everything they're saying. Right. So I had to turn it. I have to turn the Fox and then turn CNN. And then when I would turn the Fox, because I do watch it every day because I try to be.
Trying to be
balanced, okay? And I'll hear some things, and then I'll hear some morality in it and say, they're right. Even when they're talking about the black plight, when they gave the statistics about how many blacks killed how many blacks, they are right.
But it's misplaced.
Right. Number two, they're white, so they can't say it.
Exactly.
Now watch this. Here's the controversial. This is the part where we need to dig into.
Mm-hmm.
A white cop now pulls over my son, okay, for whatever,
mm-hmm.
all right? And then my son resists arrest and get brutal, try to begin to charge and do all these things and fight with the cop, okay? Mm-hmm. Something happens to my son.
Right.
All right? It becomes a white cop against a black boy.
Yep.
Always. It's never a cop against a civilian. Somehow, yada yada. It's always a white against a black. Okay, and it. So my question to you guys is, when did this start? When you're a police officer, you're a former police officer. Okay, when did this start? Where when a white cop unfortunately, either brutalizes a black man or kills it, why is that such an uproar more so?
Because it's a reminder of the context.
Uh-huh.
We try to make all of these incidents separate incidents.
Right.
But for those who have been impacted by racism, prejudice, and discrimination, uh-huh. it's all the same thing.
Okay.
It's the context. It's like a sentence. I used to teach English at Harper High School. There's a such thing as a run-on sentence. And so in our community, we're used to run-on sentences. We'll jump in the middle of a conversation, not understanding what came before it, mm-hmm. what came after it.
Right.
Historically, I went to school in Selma, Alabama, the hotbed of racism. You don't get any more racist than that.
Right.
I went to the church of the only black pastor that would allow Martin Luther King to have meetings in his church. Mm-hmm. All the rest of them were afraid of Martin Luther King, and some of them even hated Dr. King.
Hmm.
He was a part of SCLC. Most of us don't know about that.
Yeah.
You know, the young generation don't know anything about that, but he was a part of that. These are the people that walked from Selma to Birmingham. Mm-hmm. For a year.
Mm-hmm.
We jump in on something. Mike Brown got shot. We lay in the ground in Lakeshore Drive for 3 days. And then we go on about our business. There's no consistency.
Right.
So when you're trying to deal with real change, real transformation, you have to have a mindset that's developed in context.
Yeah.
So when a white police officer shoots a black child or a black man or a black woman, that is in the context of the historical relationship between white officers all the way down from down south after slavery that were used to go and bring slaves back, to kill, to lynch. They took off the Ku Klux Klan uniform, they put on police uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't understand that, then we're not going to understand the outrage and why we'll accept 600 murders of us murdering us every year in Chicago, and you can't get a black pastor to come out to say nothing about that.
Anything.
You won't get them to put a dollar for
they
the youth program. You won't get them to do a GED program. You won't get them in the prisons to help these fathers.
Mm-hmm.
But if one white police officer kills one black child,
mm-hmm.
I mean, you get all of this outroar and rioting and burning and boycotting. What about the 600 children every year?
It's amazing
because we want to run on sentence. We don't want a full context.
Right. So Chicago is all the churches emptied, not all of them. A lot of them emptied Sunday, like yesterday. Okay, in the streets for something that happened in New York. Okay, Inglewood has been murdering kids for years. Okay, and these same pastors, these same pastors, they might have said something.
Get two fingers ready.
Yeah, but they did not rally their troops. Okay, so now. We are fighting a Ferguson and New York battle in Chicago, okay? And
I'm going to disagree with you there.
Okay, I was in the street yesterday, not marching, but we were at the light because y'all was marching for something that happened over there. And I didn't see us come together like we supposed to with all the murders that I've been seeing.
Okay, y'all
going to
kick me out right after this.
Okay,
We need.
I'm not going to kick you out because they're going to kick me out first.
listen. I salute the demonstrations, I salute the protests, but we need intelligent advocacy.
Mm-hmm.
If police are murdering citizens, we need to have conversation with the police and the jurisdictions that hire police.
Yeah.
I was a police officer in Inglewood. 99% of the population in Inglewood is African American. 80% of the population of the police department were Caucasian.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're not from the community, your purview or perception and how you handle people from that community is going to be different.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the things that we're not talking about. So when we only have 30% of the African-American population that votes, then we want to, on the back end, react to something that we created being lazy and being ignorant.
Laziness.
We got to stop acting stupid, and we have to start employing our mind. We have to become thinkers again.
Yeah.
We need the W.E.B. Du Bois and the Frederick Douglasses and the Martin Luther Kings. They were not just out there just doing stuff. They were using intelligent advocacy, and this is what we need. We're having the wrong conversations, the wrong strategies, in the wrong places with the wrong people that provide us no results. 2 more months from now, we're going to be doing this again.
Yeah.
Next year, we're going to be doing this again.
Yeah.
And we keep going over the same thing in the wilderness, like the children of Israel, 40 years wandering, not getting anywhere.
No way.
When are we going to get somewhere?
Yeah. I have to jump in. I've been quiet. Okay. And I must say, guys, I respect and appreciate everything y'all saying. But none of this thing, you use the word strategy several times. You got to understand what we are receiving or experiencing is the direct onslaught of a strategy being imposed. None of these things are by design. You have to clearly look at it. There is a plan. It's a plan to keep the confusion. Sometimes the confusion is a method. It's a madness that keeps the power in place. It gives them a reason. The Democratic Party creates a problem so they can come and solve it. So they can have another program that's subsidized by the government so they can write this grant to get all this money. And then they disperse a little bit from the bottom to employ a few people to create the stats to say we have employed people, while the bulk of it is going into the grant writers and the other people who really have nothing to do to make the program work. And then it runs out. Then they have to create another problem so they can get another. All of these things are by design. It has to get to the core of the people that are deciding no longer to be victims. Now, let's think about it. Taxpayers pay the police. And the people that are victimized by them, hopefully, are taxpayers. But then taxpayers has a whole other meaning to people who pay different percentage, I mean, different amounts based on percentage. Because depending on your income, 10% is nothing to a person who's a millionaire. So they don't consider you a taxpayer. So thinking about all that's happening, there's a strategic thing that's taking place that has to be addressed, not just from a political perspective, not even from a spiritual perspective. It has to be not spiritual, I want to say religious perspective. We got to get back to core values in people. People don't have them no more. People that parents aren't training their kids how to behave. I see so much confusion in kids. And as Red Fox used to tell a joke, follow ugly home, ugly gonna open the door. Okay. You see a rude kid in your classroom, you see a rude kid on the street, follow them home. There's gonna be a rude parent that has taught them this rude behavior. And I've delved over into my own controversial corner topic, but we can put together programs, strategies, and all of these things alike until we catch it right here, right now, and begin to make a new norm. And the media has done it. One of the Facebook listeners made an assertion to a movie when they talked about the Cosby Age. When in the 80s, the Cosby Show, they impacted us. Be honest, we're all about the same age. Right. And that show impacted us. It showed us a whole nother image of what a black family could or should look like. And the media tried to say it's unrealistic because they wanted to show us James in Florida. But there was still the Heathcliff and Claires going on. We just didn't know them. Right. And it's because we see them, we saw them, we all aspired to go that route. And many of us did. A different world. They did. And it had a huge awakening. And there was a generation of young black people who were militant, but they had a strategic plan in their approach because they wouldn't get trained academically. Right. But the media was strategic because they then bought BET and they changed the programming. And we got caught up in glory and position.
They bought BET. BET was sold.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Because you can't buy it unless
it's
for sale.
You can't buy it unless it's for sale.
I appreciate it. Right. Thank you I stand corrected. Yes. Thank you, sir.
That speaks to a bigger problem. If I have to get my definition from TV.
Yeah.
Right.
That was going down that road.
And TV is controlled by people who don't like me.
Thank you.
This is where
we got there.
When we get on BET, we have Minister Society. We have How
Come on,
High.
That's what
Baby
I'm
Boy.
We have Soul Plane.
106 in
and
Park.
Baby Boy. 106 in Park.
And
40-year-old
no 10
men.
News.
And Martin.
Garbage.
We have 40-year-old men talking about they're the biggest drug dealer in Miami and they're the police. And these are the stars that we put in front of a generation because they don't have the foundation of family.
Right.
The job of a father.
And they didn't do that. We did that before it was sold.
Well, this is how we did it. The job of a father is to define the nature of his children. And so when we take materialism and misogyny and we make that the objective and the goal, then that becomes the culture in the context in which the black mindset is created. God. And we think that these mindsets are just coming and being pulled out of the air. There's a reason why little boys are wearing their pants around their ankles. They saw it on television. Right. There's a reason he's got French braids on one side, powder puff afro on the other side, 5 earrings in the left ear, 2 in the nose. He didn't wake up like that.
No, he didn't.
That identity was given to him. And until us as men come back and recapture our homes and become sexually responsible, because I'm looking at Ivana Salant with a guy on there with 37 children by 19 different women, and they're foolish. Applauding him, and they're putting him on TV. Foolish. I want to know, where are all the black attorneys, black business people, black entrepreneurs? Why are all of those who are dysfunctional in our community given so much press, so much time, and all these reality shows? You got all these women throwing bottles and shaking their tails in clubs. Mm-hmm. Where are all of our black nurses and black congresswomen? There are thousands of them out mm-hmm. there. Why are they not getting time? Because the people who control medium don't are controlling the mental perceptions of people, right. and they want people to believe that we are savages in mm-hmm. line with their racism.
Listen.
Until we stop watching that junk
exactly.
and putting them out of off. Business and creating yeah. other avenues, we're going to keep yes. staying in the same boat.
I want all of my, I want all of the white listeners to know something.
Lord have mercy.
When something happens in a neighborhood, a shooting or whatever, and the media arrives, if I'm standing there with a suit and he has a mic, he does not want to talk to me.
No, that's
I
the
need,
truth.
They I need all me. Of the white listeners to understand this. Right. He does not want to talk to
or
me.
Or if you look the part, if but don't I speak the part, they cut you out too.
He wants to find Day-Day Bunim right. with his
broken English,
just like he said, broken English, what had happened, because that's what the media want.
That's their job.
The rest of African Americans to see. That's what it is. That's what they want them to see.
Mm-hmm.
I do want to address something that you said as a police officer. Now,
Apostle
me and this
Hinton. I'm sorry, Apostle Rodgers.
Apostle Rodgers. Now, we go back. We go yeah. back. And when he walked in the room, I said, oh, yeah, we go back a while. Now, everybody has their own lives that they live. I'm going to ask you, as a past police officer,
yes, sir.
How many African-American police officers across the country do you believe it is? Just throw out a random number, because I want to deal with the issue that's happening right now.
Out of 13,000 in Chicago, we've probably got about, I'd say around 5,000 of the 13,000 in Chicago are police officers, both in the field and in administration.
So would you be comfortable to say that at least 10,000 across the country, African-American police officers?
I'd say a little bit more, probably yeah. about 60,000 police officers.
60,000. Let's take a modest. Let's drop that by 10, just to even deal with a familiar number. 50,000 mm-hmm. African American police officers. Mm-hmm. Right now, here's where I have to live into the. I have to live in the truth. Now we have 1, 2, 3, 4 African Americans sitting here at the table, and one white gentleman. I'm going to ask the white gentleman this question first. Have you ever been pulled over, other than your lights, you know, something that's obvious, you blew a red light, have you ever been pulled over by an officer and wrongly pulled over, and you asked the officer, why were you pulled over, and he had no explanation? Have you?
No.
You have not?
Mm-mm.
Sir, have you been pulled over by a police officer?
Alvin Carter.
Uh-huh. Have you been pulled over? Same question.
Because of the car I was driving?
Have you ever been wrongly pulled over by a
police
officer?
Oh, man, I can't. Ever since I've been driving.
Okay.
From the age 16.
State your nationality. You African American?
That's what they told me.
Okay. Walter, you?
Yeah, with my family in Darien, Illinois, white community, I got pulled over because I was the wrong color.
Yeah, and we call that DWB, driving white black. Yeah. I've been pulled over because I was black. I just want you to answer the question. Have you been pulled over by a police officer?
Yes.
Okay, so we got 1, 2, 3, 4 brothers that's been pulled over mm-hmm. by officers simply because they were black. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is a systematic problem that we have to address, and we cannot act like it does not exist.
Yeah.
All right? Now, here's the problem. We are demonized to... As we come up, because of what the media trains, and some of it comes from our families, we are automatically demonized as the bad guy right off the bat. And if you're listening, I want to show you this. If you're over 40 and you're white, a lot of you guys don't believe this exists. If you're under 30 and you're white, you know, in fact, it does. If you don't believe me, look and see who's in the street marching.
Right.
50% of them are young white. You know why? Yeah. They go to the same schools. They live in the same neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. they listen to the same music, unlike we did in our generation. Mm-hmm. I was proud when I saw that. Mm-hmm. But this is an issue, a real issue, that we cannot come with our preconceived thoughts. Mm-hmm. We have to look at the truth. I don't believe you're gonna see God unless you deal with the truth. Mm-hmm. And the truth is, the most dangerous species on the face of the earth today is a black male.
Mm-hmm. That's true. And in danger. We're in danger.
Well, here's some truth for us to swallow. Officers are shooting white kids too, and it's not hitting the news.
Now, here's my question. Over 50,000 African American cops, right? Mm-hmm. How many times has a young white male been shot by an African American cop and killed?
Let's answer that after the break. We'll go to Controversy Corner. And we'll be right back. This is Sir Walter Jones Show.
UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Ladies, what do you want to know? How bad do you want to know it? What are you willing to do to find out? Tune in to the Men's Chronicles right here at the Sir Walter Jones Show at UBM Praise.
At this time, I have the honor to present to you the moral leader of our nation. A great, dedicated man. A philosopher of a non-violent system of behavior.
Due to some violent content, parental discretion is advised.
Politics. Doctrine. Current events. Let's meet at the Controversy Corner on the Sir Walter Jones Show here on UBM Praise.
This is Keep It Real Carter here at that controversial intersection of racism and class, culture, ethnicity. Yeah, it's like 8 streets running down the street at the same time. In fact, I was late today because I wasn't part of a protest. We was blocking off an alley. The truth be told, one of the reasons racism exists, not just because of ethnicity and gender, but it's by what we see. What we see determines how we react. So I have to address behavior. One of the biggest problems is parents aren't learning how to teach their children properly on both ends of the spectrum, because babies are not born racist. You have the black people, and they have these images. You know, we love to project an image. Hip hops, the thug look. We have the militants, the Afrocentric garb. And then we look across the street at the white people. Some of them are nerds, punk rock, goths. And you got the good old boys. You have your Hispanics, your SEs. And then there's their own subculture divides even there. We define ourselves by how we look. And then because we look a certain way, by how we act. Because we got to act the part because we look the part. The problem is looking the part and acting the part keeps us apart. Mm-hmm. I have to ask a question about some significant change that needs to take place. Leaders, and I'm speaking to my black leaders now, in light of all that's been done in protests in response to what's happened away from our direct communities, are you really stepping up because of the glamour, or you really won't change? if you were really interested in change, you would hear or see consistency. Or are you just capitalizing on an event? Mm. Are you just trying to seize a moment so you can have your 15 minutes because you feel like I should be the one that is the focus point? See, we have the perpetuation of propaganda that seems to control the minds of everybody involved from one perspective or another. Old man once taught me this. I miss that man. Believe half of what you see and none of what you hear. Because most of the time what you hear is hearsay. So how do we resolve this? We got to get to know our neighbor beyond the clothes, beyond the skin, and get to meet them heart to heart, breast to breast. Let's learn to fellowship and not just separate and be on a couple of fellas on different ships passing by. That's abbreviated, but that's controversial enough.
Amen. Controversial Corner right here. So Walter Jones Show every day around this time on UBM Praise. I want to go to Facebook here. Abronia Scott, Tony.
Father.
We haven't seen that, y'all.
Astrid.
Yes. That's Abronia Scott's theme song. Anyway. Tony Brashear, Buddy Gill. We've got Demetria Williams Pitts. Now that's Abba's Nana. That's now she's using her real name. She's out of debt, I guess. Joe Hill, Art Lewis. All of these people chimed in. George E. Woodards. That's Pop Woodards, y'all. That's
my King. Spiritual.
Yes, Anthony King. They're here. They're chiming on Facebook. I can't read them all. It's a lot, and I know they're gonna really. they're all gonna get in trouble, I'm sure. So this is a very hot topic here. Now, with just the few minutes that we have left here, because I want to play a clip that lead us out of here by Charlie Chapman, which will really probably many of you have never heard it before, but I think it was apropos. A subject about African American young men panel. Okay, now African American young men keep getting in trouble. They have, you could be 13 years old, 12 years old, and have a rap sheet, tall, okay, already. Mm-hmm. Okay, I've seen this too much. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then they go out there to keep committing crimes and then get back in jail. All right, now, something happens where they might be doing something and then they get in trouble with the cop. Cop pulls them over, there's a tussle, and then he dies. Mm-hmm. All right? Shouldn't there be some type of responsibility in our young people, though, when an official or someone, an authoritative figure, gives you a directive to do? Mm-hmm. It could be the possibility of saving your life.
Yes.
Okay. Or the other. Mm-hmm. Because what we do is when a black kid is killed, all of us rally around the death of this kid. But none of us are talking about. Mm-hmm. What can we do to stop our young people from acting a fool in the street they can save their lives?
Yes.
Okay. Right. Larry, address
this. We got to look at, and there's a reason why I asked this question. Always say, when you hear somebody yelling, ouch, don't just look at the person that's yelling, ouch. Look at the person that's standing on their foot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You got to look at, there's a reaction and an action, correct? Mm-hmm. So, this thing has been systematic for so long.
Right.
Till there's a lot of things that we do in our communities that perpetuate a lot of stuff. Right. Right. If you're a single mother and 70% of the stuff in your house is stolen.
Right.
And your young man is popping you off cash in your hand.
Right.
Then he gets shot.
Mm-hmm.
Live by the sword, die by the sword.
Yeah.
You that sister I see on the 10 o'clock news. Not my baby. He loved everything. Shut up.
Shut up. Yes. Absolutely.
Shut up. Yeah. Because you're just like.
Enabled this kid.
You're an enabler.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you're the dad.
Yeah.
That hasn't been there for this kid since his conception.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You shut up.
Yeah.
Because you're the problem.
You are.
That's right.
Yeah.
You are the problem.
Yeah, instead of saying burn this down.
Instead of burn this down, no, pull your pants up.
Yes.
That's right.
And try to get control.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the problem. Now, we don't want, it's a two-sided sword.
Yeah.
We don't want to hear this in our communities,
of course not.
But it's the truth.
Yeah.
I have two granddaughters and I have two daughters. Mm-hmm. But every time I see a young man, I talk to him. Mm-hmm. And I tell him, if an officer pulls a gun and tells you you're under arrest, go ahead and surrender to him.
Right.
Fight him in court.
Right.
You got a better chance of living.
Yeah.
Fight him in court.
Yeah.
Don't run. If you have nothing to run for, don't run.
You're going to always lose.
You're going to lose.
Yeah. That's right.
Can I please say something before we leave? I was a police officer, and one thing that is never discussed is the culture of the police department. Mm-hmm. It is assumed that the children are acting wild and ignorant and all of that, and some of that is true. Mm-hmm. No matter how ignorant your child is, no police officer has the right to murder your child.
Like the 13-year-old that was killed in 2 seconds when they pulled up.
So no matter what your child is supposedly doing, the police officers, we are trained. There's a use of force model that we are trained in that you have to understand and graduate the academy. You can't graduate from the police academy until you've mastered use of force. Mm-hmm. It starts off with verbal command.
That's why
it moves into forceful command. It moves into restraints. It moves into taser, baton, handcuffing, call for backup. Murder is the last thing. Mm-hmm. So to jump from verbal conversation to murder, we don't know because we're not in that arena. We're not in squad cars every day. Mm-hmm. We don't know what's going on. I've had 1,000 encounters. I was on the job for 7 years and I left the police department because of the culture of the police department. They protect one another. Mm-hmm. They lie. They don't tell the truth. Me fighting with a police officer does not qualify me as an officer to kill you.
Right.
We can fight. I can call back up. I can hit you with a stick. Rodney King, probably the biggest, started the video craze. They beat him with sticks for 2 minutes.
Yeah.
They beat him with sticks for 2 minutes. We don't see that in these cases. We don't see a Mike Brown getting beat with sticks. We don't see a Mike Brown getting tased. We don't see a Mike Brown being maced. We see him being murdered. We don't see Eric Gardner being beat or any of that. We see him being choked to death on video.
Yes.
So parents, one thing you have to deal with your children on is you have to deal with them on accountability.
Yes.
Make sure you are where you need to be, doing what you need to do. That's one of the things that we can do as parents to protect our children, because the reality is, just like there are bad GDs and vice lords out here killing people on 63rd that we say nothing about, there are also bad police officers, both black and white, that care nothing about anybody because of their upbringing. And if you don't understand that, then we're going to approach these things from, oh, those kids are bad, they shouldn't be doing that, you shouldn't have fought the cop. Fighting a cop does not mean I get murdered. That's why they build penitentiaries. Mm-hmm. That's why they build prisons, because the first rule of policing is to arrest. It is not to murder people. Mm-hmm. And we got to be clear about that.
Mm-hmm. America needs an answer to the question before the break.
They don't want to listen to us. They're not going to put me on the news to tell the truth.
Right. You as an ex-police officer, 50,000 black officers, we need an answer to this.
We do.
Okay, and I believe the answer is in something what you just said. Mm-hmm. I personally I know what the answer is. Mm-hmm. If I'm a black cop and a white kid, I don't care if he's strung out, tearing a place up, high on whatever, I'm gonna shoot him in the leg. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna try to take him down. I'm gonna do everything I can to keep from killing him.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you know what'll happen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So I need to ask you, and I need you to address this as a past police officer. Out of 50,000 black cops, why is it that you rarely hear a white youth being killed by a black cop? Answer that question.
Well, here's the biggest picture. Here's the biggest thing is black police officers aren't even assigned half the time to white districts in Chicago.
Right.
If you are...
Oh, I've seen guys high on stuff.
I want you to hear me.
Mm-hmm.
Black police officers...
So you say the opportunity is limited.
Well, it's done on purpose.
Because they know how their children behave.
The people that hire police officers, first of all, don't hire the same number of African-American police officers, and then they assign them to areas where they come from. I lived in 6. They assigned me to District 7, which was Englewood. Yeah. Okay, they're not going to assign me to 25 up north.
Right.
They're not doing that.
That's not going to happen.
When you go up 25 up north, you might see one or two of us, and then those guys have tenure, which means they're working the daytime. They're writing tickets. They're not dealing with high crime stuff.
So do you believe that that's the answer?
That's part of it. This stuff is not simple. It's part of it.
It's part of it.
But here's the other part. African-Americans come from a culture where we've learned not to exhibit that type of violence against that population. We've learned to exhibit it against ourselves.
I was about to.
So when you get a black police officer in a black neighborhood, he's 10 times more likely to abuse a black suspect than a white officer. Because a white officer doesn't want the stigma of being racist.
Right.
It's very rare that that happens. But when it does happen, then they put it on the news to make it seem like it's what's going on every day.
Right.
And so those are the things that we're challenged with when you have a racist-driven media creating
a
racist-driven mindset.
Mm-hmm. There's something gone viral where there's a white cop using excessive force with a black young man in the mall. Then a white civilian intervenes and pulls the cop off of the young man. And the cop begins, and he's holding and pinning the cop down. The cop is fighting and hitting him. Then a black cop comes in gingerly and very carefully to try to pull the civilian off the guy. I thought that the black cop's reaction was very noticeable. I mean, it brought, I'm saying, he is being gingered. This guy is attacking an officer. He is committing a crime within himself. But he's a white guy, so he's being extra careful. I think that, to your question and your point, one, they don't worry about putting us in that position because we're not going to be as effective because of the fear of the outcome. Because the fear of the outcome. That black cop was being careful because no matter what he had on his clothes, his skin was black. And no matter what clothes that civilian had on, his skin was white. So he was he had privilege.
But again, I hear what you're saying, Apostle Rodgers. But I'm trying to answer the question from all these people who have young black children in their family. We've seen this all week with the marching against no police supposed to shoot a man dead. You're right. We've heard that argument already. But ain't nobody talking about what should how should I raise my boy when he leaves the house and go to school. He needs to act like a gentleman. And he needs to be law-abiding, okay?
He needs first.
And yes, he needs to do that first so that this never would happen. So we won't have to march for
that's
this.
That's not true. The young man, that he was a junior at University of Chicago. He's Phi Theta Kappa. He got out of his car with a hoagie, and they shot him six times.
No.
He didn't do nothing.
No. You're going away from my point here of how do I continue to raise my son to be law-abiding so none of this the likelihood of this happening won't be so severe here. Okay, because listen,
this he is
will
the
be.
Fear.
I'm talking about the murdering thing. Okay,
right.
he will be profiled because he's black. We got that.
Period.
But he don't have to die because he could still be arrested without violence.
He's not supposed to die.
Yes.
But the reality, what we don't want to deal with, is we're dying every day.
That's
the reality.
Yes.
The reality is most of these police shootings are not justified. They're being made justified in a in some kind of clown court somewhere. That has nothing to do with the reality of law.
Right.
Yeah.
And so because most of us are not trained in the rule of law, we don't know the rules, you can't play the game. You're going to be victimized.
No. You're trying to say something, Aaron.
Yeah, I wanted to, addressing your issue, how do we raise children across the board, whether black or white, where they will be law-abiding citizens? So I've been thinking about this issue for quite some time. We have lost in our culture honor.
Yes,
that's true.
With the absence of fathers in the family, there has been a vacuum of this dynamic called honor, and we need a restoration of that by a resurrection of fatherhood in the household. Yes. Now, speaking to the young ones, just because authority abuses its rights and privileges does not justify you acting lawless.
That's true.
And rejecting and abusing authority. You have a responsibility as a citizen to honor the civil authorities that are amongst you.
Now, I will say this too. I have a lot of friends that's police officers, and I have to say this. I wouldn't want to be a police officer right now to save my life because there's a lot and people need to see this. We can't reverse this thing and start looking at the cops as the bad guys because now you've crossed in on the other side of racism. Now you're it's the same thing as driving while black. You're seeing a police officer as the enemy. And that's not true. There's
We have to correct our mindset because we're approaching dangerous situations.
That's what I'm saying.
With an assumption that these guys are not dangerous. Police are trained to fire guns. They're trained to wrestle. They're trained to subdue. And if that person's mindset is not the proper mindset, which is something I've been advocating for years, we need to do yearly psychological evaluations of police officers.
Richard Pryor said it best.
Because we have these guys out here that are suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome.
This is true.
They have not been diagnosed, and they're still in squad cars.
That's true.
They're still in undercover squad cars.
Yes.
And they're still working as functioning adults when reality is they're mentally distressed and they're murdering people. I know police officers that just up and smacked people. I've pulled up as a police officer on the scene on a traffic stop. The guy's doing nothing, and he gets slapped in the face. Now, I don't care how saved you are, how much tongues you got, how much blood of Jesus, how many Bibles you got in your trunk. Yeah. If a man smacks you in your face for nothing, you're going to defend yourself.
But the problem is
we don't understand the power of the pen, and when that police officer writes that report, this guy was combative, and I had to shoot him. You didn't tell the part where you smacked this guy in front of his wife and his children. You didn't tell the guy where you kicked this guy in his groin, or you put drugs under his seat, because I've drove up on those incidents, and I'm telling y'all, this is from experience.
Yes.
This is not stuff I read about in the book. This is stuff I've lived, and I left the police department because of it.
Dishonesty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's anger.
Listen,
there's
anger. Richard Pryor said it best. Mm-hmm. I just shoot my cars, but the police shoot niggas.
Yeah.
You have to be careful how you behave.
Yeah. There's anger in citizens, and there's anger in the police department, because man is man. Okay. And then I think racism.
You better deal with that.
I think there's mental illness all over the place. Okay.
Yes.
And you're right. And I think, again, I'm not going to leave until I settle this.
Your question, Walter, is the fact of the matter is, don't have your head in the sand.
Don't do it.
If you're an African American black child, if you're a parent, you better tell your young men.
Please.
Number one, like that video I sent you, number one, be a law-abiding citizen.
Yes.
Right? So you don't have nothing to run from.
Right.
Right? Number one. Because 70% of the chances you being approached by an officer in a life and death situation is already depleted.
Right.
If you don't have nothing to run from, then don't run.
Don't run.
Another
right?
Thing. No, close then, your mouth.
And absolutely. Close your mouth.
Yeah.
If an officer comes to you, and he commands you, and he offers a command, and he has that weapon, and it looks like he's going to use it, surrender, and it doesn't make you any less of a man.
Right.
So we have to train, especially black young men, that you have to carry yourself a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I dress, when I fly in a suit minus the tie because of the way I get treated. I don't get treated like a thug in the street because of the way I look.
Yes.
And I don't respond when they try to talk to me a certain way.
I don't respond to that. Exactly. Yeah. So we have to train our black young men that, because that's, and my wife is white. So, and I go to a multicultural church, right? But we have to understand all people are not prejudiced.
No.
We have to cut through the great divide.
Mm-hmm.
But we got to tell our black children the truth.
Mm-hmm.
You might think that you're the same as your or Johnny, and you are, but to like you said, an officer that's on Xanax or whatever this stuff is, you're not. I'm going to end by saying this: I have been in over 3,500 homes because of my previous jobs and my job. You know that one, one in houses. I can't name how many police officers. Houses I've been to. Now let me give you guys a peek into what I see. Most of the police officers are punks at home. They wives run over, you would not believe it, big bad cops, they wives run over them, they kids curse them out, right? They gotta, and he can't say anything because he's a brute at home, right? He's pissed off, he goes out in the street, he is pissed. I'm telling you, I'm in the house, wife cursing him out, kids running up, I hate you, I wish you would die, blah, 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 blah. He goes out, you run a red light and start lipping off. He's taking that anger out on you. And to what you said, it's the truth.
And this
we
is what I'm saying.
We have a lot of, and for you people to say it don't exist, you have your head in the sand.
And this is what I'm saying. We have to raise our children. That's the first thing. We don't want to do that. We don't want to spend time with children because we've created a culture where we want materialism more than relationship. So our children get thrown in a corner somewhere. We stick them in front of a computer or a TV, and then we let TV raise our children. And then when things happen, then we want to respond.
Yeah.
What I'm talking about is a proactive approach in thinking. Yes. We have to think differently.
I agree with
you. The possibility of your child leaving home and not coming back is greater than ever before.
Absolutely.
We have situations where children are going to school and other children are coming to school to kill everybody in the school.
That's true.
So we've created this culture of violence that we don't do anything about. It has to be addressed systemically. Yes. It has to be a strategy that's long term. We have to deal with it. We swept it under the rug. We've wished it to go away. But until we do the hard work, the systematic work of dealing with what we're dealing with in the nation, right, we're going to continue to repeat this.
Walter, you're going to have to have another show
with this
panel
just
to talk about what do we do about us-on-us crime.
Yeah, that's good. Let's do that. If y'all can come back next Monday, I would love that. Aaron,
I'll be here.
Can you? Yeah. Okay, that's wonderful. Thank you. Monday, y'all join us again. Monday, we're going to talk about this black-on-black situation here. And I want you here, Aaron, for this because that's important because it's going to affect you. All right? This has been great. Go to Spreaker.com. The show will be up tonight. Spreaker.com. Share this with everybody you know. I don't care who it is. Share it. Spread out there like crazy, okay? I want this to be the number one show of the year. We got to educate the people on this particular issue, okay?
We got to heal as a nation.
Yeah, we really do. We have to heal. Listen, I'm going to play The Great Dictator, 1940, from Charlie Chaplin. This man this is probably the best. Well, this is he comes from talk. What they call him? The silent movies.
Yeah.
This is the first talkie.
He's a brilliant man.
And he's brilliant. And this is the first time you heard him talk. And when he talked, he said something that was as extraordinarily interesting.
And the industry cut it.
Yeah.
They cut him up at the as a result of that.
Yes.
And you like it.
And when you listen to it, you'll see why they had to cut it. Okay? Some of you never heard this before. All right, we got to go, y'all. We see you tomorrow. We're talking about domestic abuse tomorrow. Domestic abuse with Crystal Waters and Davinia will be here tomorrow as well. Okay, y'all, we got to go. Love you guys. Thanks again. Okay, this is the Sir Walter Jones Show.
I'm sorry. I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone. The good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful. But we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world. Millions of despairing men, women, and little children. Victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, and dictators die. And the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't give yourselves to brutes. Men who despise you, enslave you, who regiment your lives, tell you what to do, what to think, or what to feel, who drill you, diet you, treat you like cattle, use you as cannon fodder. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men, with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines. You are not cattle. You are men. You have the love of humanity in your hearts. You don't hate. Only the unloved hate, the unloved and the unnatural.
Soldiers, don't fight for slavery, fight for liberty. In the 17th chapter of St. Luke it is written, the kingdom of God is within man, not one man nor a group of men, but in all men, in you. You, the people, have the power to create machines, the power to create happiness. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful, to make this life a wonderful adventure. Then in the name of democracy, let us use that power, let us all unite. Let us fight for a new world, a decent world, that will give men a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power, but they lie, they do not fulfill that promise, they never will. Dictators free themselves, but they enslave the people. Now let us fight to fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason, a world where science and progress will lead to all men's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!
You've been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Radio Show, where he provides you with a biblical perspective for your everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones by visiting him online at www.sirwalterjones.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/The Sir Walter Jones Show. Stay tuned until next time with The Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.